Here at All for Jesus Church, we are now on our Sunday worship service. We are live here on Facebook, and you're able to see our replay on YouTube as well. We are a full gospel, non-sectarian, non-denominational church. We believe in Trinity, that our Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit are one God. Let's begin worshiping our Lord with an opening song, More of You. Praise God.
Going through, you know what their hearts desire, you know their dreams, Lord God.
prayer requests, and we lift them up to you, Lord. Lord, we pray to stretch out your mighty hand upon them, Lord. And we pray for your divine intervention, for your divine miracle in each and every one of us, Lord God. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you continue, Lord, to guide your children, Lord God, so that we can live here on earth to be the light, as a light and salt of this world, Lord God. So that, Lord God, we can fulfill the task you have given to us, Lord God. And help us, Holy Spirit, to reach the destiny that God has given to us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, Lord, for we believe, Lord, that in this service, in this worship service, your name is lifted up. Our lives, Lord, ourselves will be less, and you will be lifted up more than anything and more than anyone. As we praise you, as we worship you through songs, through our tithes and offering, and even in listening to your words, Lord, let our hearts, Lord God, be filled with joy as we receive your words, as we listen to your words. Lord, hide my father under the shadow of your wings, Lord, that everything that will utter from his mouth, only your will, Lord God. And let there be power and anointing, Lord, that everyone who will hear it, Lord Jesus, it does not come from my father, but from you, Lord God. And Lord, we pray that you continue, Lord, to move in our midst, that there will be salvation, there will be healing, there will be deliverance. Thank you, Lord, for this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. We give you praise, we give you honor, and every church will say, amen and amen. Praise God.
Psalm 98, verses 4 to 5. Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth in song, rejoice and sing praises. Sing to the Lord with the harp and the sound of a psalm.
Amen. Hallelujah. Let's continue to give thanks to our Lord. Hallelujah. Let's make a joyful noise, for all the glory and honor belongs to him. Amen. Praise Amen. God.
God in me, his love endures forever, for his
Lord, for that unconditional love. Thank you, Lord, because of your love, we have been set free. Amen. And we worship you, Lord. And we continue to worship you. And we declare your goodness, oh God. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Thank you.
my beloved mom to lead us to our tithes and offering message for today. Praise God.
Thank you, Minister Melissa. Amen. Hallelujah. Good morning, brother and sister in Christ. Welcome to All for Jesus Church International. Amen. And let's open our Bible in Proverbs 3, chapter 3, verse 9 and 10. Honor the Lord with your wealth and with the best part of everything you produced. Then he will fill your barns with grain and your vats will overflow with good wines. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's bow our head. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We bless your name. We exalt your name on high, Lord God. Truly, God, apart from you, we can do nothing. True God, hallelujah, it's not by might, nor by power, by my spirit, says the Lord. Lord, we love you, we adore you, we worship you, Lord God, in spirit and truth. Hallelujah. Lord, right now, hallelujah, we come to you today to honor you in our house, in your house. We present our tithes and offering, Lord Jesus, as a gift and sacrifice of honor, and we believe that you're going to bless us, Lord, and our barns will be filled with plenty and our vats will overflow. We stand on your words and we act in our faith in Jesus Christ's name. Lord, thank you, Lord God, for everything to this week, Lord God, you've done in our life. Thank you, Lord God, for loving us. And Lord, we pray to people who give their tithes and offering that you're going to bring them back hundredfold, Lord God. And those people who cannot give today, Lord God, we pray that on next Sunday, Lord, that they will give you, Lord God, their tithes and offering, Lord God. Lord, to bless them, bless their job, bless their barns, and bless them, Lord God, in their lives, Lord God. Hallelujah. And Lord, we pray that they will start to honor you first, hallelujah, in their everything that they have, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you, Lord God, and we continue, bless us, and we entrust again to you next week to be with us, to be with us in our family, in our work, in our job, and in our businesses, to bless everything, Lord God, in your name, Lord God. Lord, be with us and guide us, and we pray for your provision and in our lives, Lord Jesus. Pray that you're going to guide each one of us and to do your will, Lord God, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen.
And hallelujah. Praise God. Here at All for Jesus Church, we believe that your tithes belong to your local church. But if you believe that All for Jesus Church is your home, please send your money order or your check addressed to All for Jesus Church, All for Jesus Church, and you can mail it at P.O. Box 30653, Elmont, New York, 11003. Amen. Praise God. Let's prepare our hearts to listen to the scripture reading for today. Praise God.
2 Peter 2, verses 20 to 22. For if, after they have escaped the pollutions of the world, through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the latter end is worse for them than the beginning. For it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than having known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered to them. But it has happened to them according to the true proverb, a dog returns to his own vomit, and a sow having washed to her wallowing in the mire. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Pastor Isaiah T. Shinquan Jr.
Amen.
Thank you, Melody. Good morning, brothers and sisters. We welcome you all here in All for Jesus Church International. We thank you for joining us again this morning on our Sunday worship service. We are also live on Facebook as well as in YouTube. Our topic for today we were going to have a closer look of the doctrine, once saved, always saved. Amen. Father in heaven, in the name of Jesus, we thank thee, Father, for this day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you, Father, for this day. And be with us today, Lord, as we declare your holy words to all nations. We thank you, Lord, and bless this message, Lord. Bless this, all these people who are listening to us, Lord. And be with us always, Lord, as we declare our victory. Cover us with your most precious blood. And protect us, Lord, under the shadow of your wings. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. The doctrine of once saved, always saved teaches that it is not possible for a child of God to sin in such a way that he will be lost. Many people who undoubtedly are very sincere and possess a desire to do what is right find tremendous comfort in this doctrine. This doctrine, however, is not directed and informed in the Bible. It is an erroneous and incorrect doctrine that provides a false comfort and deceitful feeling of eternal security. Amen. Does the Bible teach once saved, always saved? The answer is no. Amen. It does not teach that doctrine. A person who has gained salvation by faith in Christ can lose their faith and the salvation that comes with it. The Bible says that maintaining faith requires great effort. Amen. A hard fight. Jude 3 verse 5. Early Christians who had already accepted Christ were told, keep working out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Philippians 2 verse 12. Before we begin, it is important to put a summary on this ideology. Even though we will be defining a doctrine called once saved, always saved, also known as eternal security, this doctrine is not a Christian belief, while it is a belief that is held and defended by some Christians. And these Christians are no less of Christian for believing in it. It is a belief that goes against Christianity. The purpose of the ideology is to explain the doctrine, then exhibit and show why it is not supported in the Bible. Everyone has the right to have their own beliefs. So, this doctrine is not being written to discredit this belief. It is only written to let Christians know that it is not a belief supported by the Bible, and in fact, goes against what the Bible actually teaches. Christians who hold and cling this belief are still Christians. It is only that belief that is not Christians. Amen. Keep in mind that most Christians who hold and grip this belief still live Christian lives that are in line with the actual teaching in the Bible. In Hebrews 3 verses 12 to 14, I'm reading in NIV. See to it, brothers, that none of you has sinful, unbelieving hearts that turns away from the living God. Amen. In verse 13, but encourage one another daily, as long as it's called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin of deceitfulness. In verse 14, we have come to share in Christ if we hold firmly till the end the confidence we had at first. Why do we cling and hold to error even when the truth is so crystal clear? Perhaps it is because we select and favor a certain formula that we find comforting. We favor and like to believe that once saved, always saved. In other words, just one and done. That's it. But it's not that really an honest interpretation of the scripture. Also from the Bible, we know that good works, including faith, which relies on good works, are necessary for remaining in Christ. They do not earn us salvation, amen? But they let God know that we accept His free gift of salvation. The Bible teaches that we can reject God's gift of salvation. And therefore, we already know that once saved, always saved is false, amen? The false and unbiblical doctrine of being saved by faith alone, while seemingly, oh, and obviously offering eternal security, offers very little security when clearly examined, amen? For example, we sometimes see good Christians, men, amen? We see sometimes good Christian men turn away from the gospel and commit a very serious sin. If we say that committing such a very serious sin had no effect in one's salvation, we contradict the gospel. Amen. If a person who claims to be a Christian because of a born-again experience commits such a sin, only to later say that his original born-again experience was not a true one, but that his after the fact was true. How does he know? With clean, spotless, and moral certainty that this is so? When he had been convinced that his first experience was true, even if such a Christian does not fall into serious sin, how does he know that he will not do so in the future? In 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 20 to 22, if we have escaped the corruption of the world by knowing our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and we are again entangled within it and overcome, they are worse off at the end than they were at the beginning. In verse 21, it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than to have known it and turn and then turn their backs on the sacred command that was passed on them. In verse 22, of them, the Proverbs are true. A dog returns to its vomit, and a sow that is washed goes back to her wallowing in the mud. The false doctrine of faith alone usually leads a person to put his faith on his own estimation and evaluation of how true his faith really is. And trusting in one's judgment is not secure at all, amen? People believing in once saved, always saved will agree that there are verses in the Bible that say we can lose our salvation. There is no question on the existence of these verses among Christians. However, these people also claims that there are verses that prove once saved, always saved. Since they see both of the stakes, they decide that the verses they misread to promote once saved, always saved must be true. And they will ignore and push aside the verses that they read correctly about losing salvation. This is a bad idea, and it has a snowball effect. In other words, it has an uncompounding growth of amplification. The problem here is that they don't go back to look at the verses that they read incorrectly to arrive at their once saved, always saved conclusion before junking and rejecting the verses that they read correctly out. Then they begin to form and construct all their understandings of the Bible on this faulty idea. And this prevents them in accepting many actual truths of the Bible. Amen. Amen. There are Bible verses that contradict the doctrine of once saved, always saved. The Bible warns against serious things that will keep a person from entering God's kingdom. If salvation could not be lost, such warnings would be pointless and meaningless. Instead, the Bible shows that someone who has been saved can fall away by returning to a practice of serious sin. Amen. Hebrews 10, verse 26, I'm reading it NIV, it states that if we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of truth, no sacrifice of sin is left. Jesus emphasized the importance of maintaining faith by giving an illustration in which he compares himself to a vine. And his followers compares to branches on that vine. Some of them would at one time demonstrate faith in him by their fruits or action, yet would later fail to do so and be thrown out with a fruitless branch, losing their salvation. Yes. John 15 verses 1 to 6, the parable of the vine and the branches proves it is possible for a Christian to fall from grace. Yes. Jesus said in John 15 verse 2, he cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit. Jesus went on to say in John 15 verse 6, if anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into fire, and burned. Notice the branches, brothers and sisters. Notice the branches on these passages represent individual Christians, amen? Not individual denomination. There is no denomination in existence at the time Jesus spoke these words. Denominations are man-made, amen? If anyone today would follow the pattern for the New Testament church given to us in the Bible, there would be no denomination in existence today, amen? Apostle Paul used a similar illustration saying that Christians who do not maintain their faith will be chopped off or cut off. Romans 11 verses 17 to 22, Christians are commanded to keep on watch. Matthew 24 verse 42. Chapter 25, verse 13. Those who fall asleep spiritually or by not fully performing the works that Jesus commanded would lose their salvation. Romans 13, verses 11 to 13. Revelations 3, verses 1 to 3. Many scriptures shows that those who have been saved must still endure faithfully to the end. Amen. Matthew 24 verse 13. But he who stands firm to the end will be saved. And Hebrews 10 verses 36, you need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what He has promised. Amen. Also in Revelation 2 chapter verses 10, we usually see so many Christians come to Christ, but then they never follow through. They don't continue in faith. They don't sink or dive into discipleship and study of the word and prayer, because they usually have been deserted and left with a false impression, much like what sometimes been assumed and considered by child baptism. And that's one and done, that's it. Or even adult baptism, that's one and done too. And those, some Christians would say, oh, well, I was baptized when I was 30 years old or 2 years old, so I'm good. And we have left people who are now in danger of eternal hellfire and darkness with the impression that they are really eternally saved. What a terrible danger. What a terrible thing to teach of followers of Jesus, who will hold us accountable if we teach such a false way. The doctrine of once saved, always saved teaches that it is not possible for a child of God to sin in such a way that he will be lost. Many people who undoubtedly are very sincere and possess a desire to do what is right find tremendous comfort in this doctrine. This doctrine, however, is not taught in the Bible. It is an erroneous doctrine that provides a false comfort and deceitful meaning of eternal security. First, let us examine some of the passages. Most of the time, used to support this doctrine concerning the Christian in Asia Minor. Amen. Peter wrote in 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 5, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. How is it that Christians are kept or guarded unto salvation? Through their faith. Amen. It is possible for a Christian to lose their faith and stop or quit believing in God. The author of the book of Hebrews warned his readers against the sin of unbelief. Hebrews 3 verse 12. See to it, brothers, that one of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. On this verse, don't overlook and ignore the fact that the author was writing to people who are already Christians. Amen. They have been saved, that's past tense, from their sins. Yet, he still warns them of the sin of unbelief. Is a Christian who loses his faith is still saved? Of course, the obvious and only logical answer is a resounding no. Others points to the book of John 10 verses 27 to 28 in the effort to defend the doctrine once saved, always saved. Jesus said, my sheep, listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. In verse 28, I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. Does this passage really teach once saved, always saved? That's no. Amen. Notice Jesus' words, brothers and sisters, and they follow me. This passage contains wonderful promises for Christians. However, these promises are conditional upon continually following Christ, man. Those Christians who quit or stop following Christ will not receive these promises, man. Still, others point to 1 John 3 verse 9 in order to defend their doctrine of one saved, only saved. The author of this book wrote, "No one who is born of God will continue to sin, because God's seed remains in him. He cannot go on sinning, man, because he has been born of God." John wrote that a person does not continue to sin because the seed, the word of God, continues to abide in him. However, Satan can steal the word of God out of a person's heart. Amen. If that person allows Satan to do so. In Matthew 13 verse 19, when anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away that was sown in his heart. When a Christian allows the word of God to be taken away from him, that Christian has fallen from grace and is lost. Many other passages are used in attempt to defend the false doctrine, one saved, always saved. The necessary limitations that are placed upon the length of this preaching prohibit me from addressing all these passages. However, numerous passages teach it is possible for a Christian to sin in such a way that he will be eternally lost. First, there are things a Christian must do in order to keep from falling. In 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 10, "Therefore, my brothers, be all the more eager to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never fall." Amen. This passage provides a clear implication that if a Christian does not do these things, he will fall from grace and be lost. Peter detailed in 2 Peter chapter 5, verse 9. Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 27, "No, I beat my body and make it my slave, so that after I preach to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize." The word disqualified refers to one who does not stand the test and is rejected. Apostle Paul knew that without practicing self-control, he would be rejected by God. Amen. Apostle Paul teaches the Christian in Galatia that it was possible for them to fall from grace. In Galatians 5 verse 4, I'm reading in NIV, "You who are trying to be justified by the law have been alienated from Christ. You have fallen away from grace." The Bible not only teaches it is possible for Christians to fall from grace, it gives us an example of Christians who fail from grace. Some of those Christians to whom Apostle Paul was writing in 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 16, "But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst sinners, Christ Jesus might display the unlimited patience as an example to those who would believe on him and receive eternal life." Believing, it's much more than just simply knowing, man, that Jesus is who he says he is. Consider the demons in James 2 verse 9. "You believe that there is one God. Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. The demons clearly believe and knew that He is the Christ. So, why are the demons? The answer is because even though they held the simple belief that Jesus is the Christ, they do not obey Him. Amen. Yeah. Which Jesus commanded was necessary. Amen. Amen. And what to do, we need to obey. And what do we need to do? To obey everything that Christ teaches and commanded. It is not enough to just simply believing that Jesus is the Son of God. We need to realize that all that Christ did for us, and we need to obey Him as well. As we saw above, the Bible teaches that believing is also involves obeying. Amen? So, if you are believing and obeying Jesus, then you may know that you have eternal life. However, if you stop believing and stop obeying Him, or either way, you no longer have eternal life. Amen? One of the most quoted Bible verses of the doctrine of once saved, always saved is in Romans 8, verse 1. There is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. People who use this verse to claim it proves once saved, always saved, fail to realize that no condemnation is based on the condition that you are in Christ Jesus. So, how do we remain in Christ Jesus? Jesus tells us in John 15, verses 1 to 6. Amen. Also in Romans 8, verses 29 to 30, people make a very bold claim about Romans 8, verse 29. In an attempt to prove that they are once saved, always saved, they say that they are those who God predestined. How could they probably know this? This information is known only to God, man, not man. They very well could be predestined, but there is no way for them to know this for sure. Even if someone did somehow know for sure that they were predestined, this would not prove once saved, always saved. Yes. God knows everything that is going to happen in our lives, amen, yes, before we are even been born. God foreknew the ones He predestined. God already knows who is going to be remaining in Christ, amen, when they die. Even if a person decided to turn away from God, from Christ, at some point or points during their life, all we know from this verse is that God knows who He predestined. God knows who will be remaining in Christ at the time of their death. So, He predestined them. Also, God is able to predestine whoever He would like. In addition to them, God can even predestine a non-Christian if He chooses. Amen. These verses do not exclude anyone from heaven. No one should be claiming that they know who God predestined or didn't predestine for that matter. But the word of Jesus are the most and mighty and powerful. Amen. In Matthew 7, verses 21 to 23, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Amen. But only he who does the will of my Father. Many will say to me on the day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons? and perform many miracles, then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you, amen? Away from me, you evildoers. The parable of the sower gives us insight into the issue at hand, amen? Jesus speaks of individuals who receive the gospel immediately with joy. But when affliction or persecution arises because of the word, they fall away. Amen. Mark 4, verse 16. Luke 8, verse 13. I'll give you the list, brothers and sisters, of the Bible passages of the scripture proving some individuals must continue to work out their salvation with fear and trembling.
Amen.
Number one, Philippians 2, verse 12. Brothers and sisters, read these following verses at your home. Full from grace, Galatians 5, verses 1 to 4, and Galatians 13, verse 2. B, and Galatians verse 13, be led away with error. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 17, error from the truth. James 5, verses 9, 19 to 20, weak brother may perish. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 11, fall into condemnation. James 5, verse 12, be moved away from hope. Colossians 1, verses 21 to 23, deny the Lord who bought them. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, depart from the living God. Hebrews 3, verse 12, can be a castaway. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 27, can become accursed children. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 14, remember to continue in the faith. It is not a popular viewpoint today, but I would dare to say it is a scriptural one. It might be better for our mental health to assume we are once saved, always saved. But the reality of the truth is quite different. Brothers and sisters, once saved, always saved is not only erroneous and twisting of God's written words. It is dangerous, amen? Dangerous because it usually puts people at ease and relax by thinking since they cannot lose their salvation, then they do not have to overcome sin. So they can do pretty much what they want. May God bless us all by leading you into all truth. To God be the glory. We thank you, Father, for this wonderful message that you have given unto us today, Lord. Be with us again, Lord, next Sunday on our Sunday worship service.
Yes, Lord.
We trust our lives to you, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Praise God. Truly that we have to take care of our personal relationship with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. If you want to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, now is the time. And if you want to rededicate your life to Him, I'm encouraging you to follow the prayer after me. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, I acknowledge, Lord Jesus, that I am a sinner. And Lord Jesus, forgive me for all these sins that I have committed. Lord God, I pray that you continue to cleanse me with your most precious blood, Jesus. I call upon you, for I believe you are the only way. Lord Jesus, I receive you as my Lord and my Savior. Come reign in my heart, reign in my life. Thank you, Lord, for I know, Lord, today is a new day for me, for you have given me a new beginning. Thank you, Jesus, for the eternal life. Thank you, Jesus, for you already written my name in the book of life. Thank you for sealing me with the Holy Spirit. Lord Jesus, thank you, Lord, for this day, and let me be continue to be the light of this world, Lord God, for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Praise God. If you have followed that prayer, we encourage you to go and find a local church where you can grow in the knowledge of God. Amen. Hallelujah. May I call now the praise and worship team? And we are also, you are also welcome here in All for Jesus Church. If you cannot find any church, hallelujah, we also have a YouTube. All you have to do is just write down All for Jesus Church and you can see all the worship services in that platform. Amen. Praise God. Let's sing our victory song, Look What the Lord Has Done. Amen.
Until we again return to praise your name.
Amen.
In the assembly of the saints. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, brothers and sisters. God bless.